fit the second. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I'm really looking forward to hearing this presentation, so please give a big hand to Mads Palsvig.
Well, can you hear me very well? Is that working? Not yet, no? And then I will. It's better now, yeah? Okay. Well, first, thanks a lot for that warm welcome. It's been two great days, very impressive speakers. I really enjoyed it. And I'm particularly enjoying being back in England. I've lived here some 15, 17 years. Our kids are born here. And to come out and see the countryside reminds me of all the Saturday mornings when we drove out with our three kids and had a nice pub lunch afterwards. So it's almost coming home a little bit to me. I think I can say that. So that's very nice. I think the PowerPoint presentation should start somehow. What do I do? Do I do anything? Okay. So this is a picture of my wonderful Denmark. Oh, this is the one. Perfect.
Don't press down.
Don't press down. Gotcha. What can possibly go wrong now? So this is beautiful Denmark, and one of the reasons that that I stand here is, as you all know, there are people who are destroying the nature, and someone has to do something about it. This here is my good old father, and why would I put up a picture of my father? Well, first of all, because I wouldn't be standing here without him. I was the firstborn child. He was a psychologist. He never thought he would have children. He was 41 when I was born, and he was very, very proud, and I was a very loved child, and I guess we all want to live up to our parents' expectations. That's one reason why I put it up, but I also put it up because part of what I do is I want to annoy the psychopaths in power. How can I annoy them the most? By telling them I love my father. Because as you all know, they've been trying systematically for the last 50 years to destroy family, nature, religion, national identities, pride, everything that we love. Yeah. And now it's about time we say no to that. And we're becoming more and more, we won't have it any longer. So I owe my father a lot. And that's about, well, yeah, no, I want to say he was a psychologist and he said to me, and I have three, we have three kids. He said to me, the most important thing to teach your children is these three things. Obviously the people in parliament do the opposite, as you can see here, yeah? You have to teach your children what is the difference between right and wrong, beautiful and ugly, just and unjust. If you do that, you're on your way, and you could potentially become a good father. And I'm saying, you know, you look into the politics and what they do there, it's just wrong, all of it. It's always ugly, and it's very often unjust. Yeah. So basically, we just need to be more people who step up to the plate and say no. And I understand that Ian asked me to go a little bit into my background, my story as a trader. I think we have a problem with the PowerPoint here. Matthew, what could possibly go wrong? Was it me? I don't know. Here we are. That was me. Okay, so I started as a trader. You just saw it very briefly there, yeah? Yeah, so we're sitting on a trading floor. I'm so old that we used to be sitting, this being selling, like a bear market, your price goes down, and this is buying, the horn of the bull, and the price goes up, yeah? So these are the signs we're giving. We're sitting like in two cinemas opposite each other. So the banks were sitting there giving sign, and I was one of the brokers, and they would be telling me whether I should buy or sell. And it was a great job. I was working. I started when I was 20 years old, and I was studying law and business in the evening. I took two degrees in the evening while I was working full time. So I kept myself busy. And this is a typical how it typically looks for a trader. You have a lot of screens, you have a lot of phones. I used to have two telephones, and then I had numbers next to lamps with each bank. So I knew if there were a lot of phones ringing, a lot of lights, and I knew something is happening, and I was picking up who should I talk to, who is most clever, who knows what's going on. I'd pick that up, and then you literally have 2 or 3, 4, 5 second discussions, and you would be talking that, and you'd be buying or selling, you go slam down, and you just write it down while you're taking the other phone, you're clicking that phone, and you have either bought or sold, and you go and move on. And I loved it. It was fantastic. I loved it. So I'm a recovering bankaholic. I believed, and I still believe, that it is possible for banking to be a noble job. If you think about it, you need lenders and borrowers. You need some middlemen to facilitate that. Otherwise, nothing will be working. When they're financing wars and drugs and whitewashing and helping with tax evasion and so on, it's not so good. But that's you can say that about any industry, right? Public servants, medical doctors. You can say that about any industry, really. So this would be a typical trading floor. This is Deutsche Bank. I worked for Credit Suisse and Morgan Stanley. And it was in London. I went there in 93. I said to my bosses that I took off a week to study for my final exam on business school. And I actually went to London. I had 10 job interviews, and I got a job at Credit Suisse. I want to tell a little bit about some of the important meetings I had. This is Ben Bernanke. At the time, he was member of the Federal Reserve. Later on, he became chairman of the Federal Reserve, the privately owned American Central Bank. I really think he's a good guy. I think he's a public servant doing his job. To be honest, I don't think he's an evil man at all. He has been out officially just before 2008 financial crash. He went out and publicly admitted that the Federal Reserve, the privately owned American Central Bank, was behind the Wall Street crash in 1929. The way they did that was that they removed half of the monetary base. And if there's less money in the society, then house prices will collapse, equity prices will collapse. So basically, the way they do it is they instruct all the management in all the banks to call back loans. And then everybody is just selling all assets they can in order to pay back the loans, because otherwise they will be repossessed. The securities will be repossessed. So he admitted that, but we won't do it again. Well, he clearly was clueless, wasn't he? Because a couple of years later they did it. He's famous for, he's been called Helicopter Ben, because he said that you could never have deflation because you could just print money. Now I'm just giving you a clue about what we're gonna talk about, because what I'm going to talk about, when I finish talking a little bit about myself, I'll be talking a little bit about what money is, how money is created, who makes it, and who benefits. I'll be talking a little bit about some of the solutions that I have suggested in the political party I have created, and it really is not rocket science. It's basically do the opposite of what they do at the moment. So it's really, really simple, and we'll be better off. Yeah. And then lastly, and this is something that I really want to do, and it is the combination of me working with in banking and all that in 25 years and thinking about this for 5, 6, 7 years, I want to explain really simple 3 things you can do, and then you have abundance. You have no poverty at all. And I will include Africa in that equation. The world is very wealthy. There's a lot of abundance. There's no need for anybody to suffer whatsoever. And my goal is that when you go out here, I will have explained it so well that you can explain it to your spouse, your friends, and so on. Because what I really want to do is I want this to become like Brian Gary started the whole thing. These caterpillars going along string. I want it all to come out. We have to look at the politicians. We have to demand them that they live up to our expectation, and our expectation is abundance for everybody. That's our expectation from now on. We won't accept this anymore, all the suffering, the homelessness, and all that stuff, and we can do it. And I will show you that before this evening is over. I will do it theoretically, and I will show you how in practice we are. I'll finish with that on a hopefully an upbeat tone on how we're doing it in Denmark as we speak. Okay, so back to Ben. So he was famous for this, being called Helicopter Ben, because he said that you could just create money out of thin air, and that is literally what they do. So
somebody said to me the other day when we had some issues, and they said, "Do you think it was sabotage?" You know, and I mean, you know, obviously we're not blasé, but we're not paranoid either. So you know, it's a case of holding it somewhere in between, but. I think, unfortunately, we're just down to the technical stuff. So we're just going to get the live stream back up. So, and as soon as that's back up, then we'll get going. So maybe you just want to tell a story that...
Yeah, I can tell a story about what happened in Copenhagen when I was having a speech. Something similar happened. So we were going to film. I was going to make... when Obama was going to Denmark to make a speech. And people had paid 25,000 kroner, £2,500 to attend to this war criminal, yeah? So they paid for that. So I thought, okay, the Danes are totally brainwashed. So, and I know it's not, as you can imagine, it's not popular to tell people that what they believe in is wrong. So I had to do it in a proper way. So I made a presentation with 100 slides, or more than 2 hour speech about Obama. And when I was going to do that, when we came, and of course it was being filmed, and when I came in, the alarm was going, like, as in so loud that it was physically painful. It was in the hallway. You could not physically be there. You had to get out. And even up in the where I was making the speech, you could hear it. So it was obviously impossible. It took about an hour before anyone came, and you know, I'm sure there are laws about you can't have that, yeah. And then the next week, because obviously it was not proper. Then we came back the next week, and halfway through, then the electricity went down. So then they sabotaged it 2 weeks in a row. And I just said, okay, fine, we'll come back next Saturday again. And the third time we went and we did it. So it came out 2 weeks delayed. But I did get the message across that that Obama is not such a good guy after all. Yeah. I think I did it in English as well. You can find it on my YouTube channel if you like, and Mats Palsvig on YouTube there somewhere on the playlist. So let's move on. We were talking with I was mentioning. Are we good to go? By the way, Matthew, or yeah, all right. So I met this gentleman in 2004 in Paris together with Professor Hannah Scobie from London. London School of Economics, and I had a conversation with this man, and very interesting. I met a lot of these central bankers. They like to bridge academia, traders like myself, and then the central bankers. They did it, and part of the reason was probably to find out how clueless I was about how money is created, I guess, because I didn't at that time know how it was done. And this is Sandra Pianalto from the Cleveland federal governor. I met her just before the financial crisis in 08. And I suggested to her that maybe an idea, in order not to have any people losing their homes, getting them repossessed, maybe the government could offer to temporarily buy all the properties for anybody who couldn't pay the mortgage for 80% of what they paid for it. And then let them live there, rent their own home for a low price, maybe 1-3% of the value of the house. That way most people could actually afford to stay in their houses. And then with an option to buy it back within 10, 20 years or whatever you want, because the government can create inflation. So with, if the government, I mean, the government can just create inflation, have the house prices go back up over the next 10, 20 years. So if they did what I suggested, not a single American would have lost their home. And her answer was that it was too complicated. And then a few months later, Bear Stearns went down, and you know the story, right? Lehman Brothers, all the, was it AIG went down as well? Another, I mean, and then they had the troubled TARP, what is it, Troubled Asset Repurchase Program or something like that, bailout of $780 billion that America gave to the bankers. The bankers that just created the financial crisis got $780 billion. So, I think I was on the track. Ian asked me to get into talking about what was the trigger, and I was like, "This is weird. It's so simple. Why are they not interested in that?" And then I was working at Morgan Stanley in 2011. I met this nasty piece of woman. See, her name is Janet Yellen, and at that time she was an ordinary member of the Federal Reserve. I think maybe it might be a requirement to meet me because they all become chairman or chairwoman shortly after. I don't know, but maybe not. No, I'm just kidding. And no, we had a big dinner, a number of traders, number of academics, and she was there. And I thought this is a great opportunity. I thought she was a public employee, clueless about doing her job. I was not aware we were colleagues. I was not aware at that time Federal Reserve was privately owned, because I might have been a bit more courteous if we were colleagues after all, right? I mean, you have a colleague and they screw up. It's just in your blood, you kind of a little bit more polite. But if it's a public servant, yeah, and you're a banker, then it's fun to go against it. So I was like blowing my whole career up when I did that. Not very wise of me, and my poor wife is still here, so lucky me. But the thing is, I was grilling her about why is it whenever there is a country that is financial crisis, it always end up worse after the IMF and World Bank goes in. She did not like me a lot. But it's true. I mean, why would you charge 10% interest from a country that is on its knees, right? And then when they can't pay, why would then you then ask them, when they can't pay because they don't have enough tax revenues, why would you then ask them to cut 30% of the public service workers, right? Why would you do that? Because then obviously the private sector will collapse as well because there's no purchase power, right? So it's by design. This is how they loot countries. They are it's a mafia. They are psychopaths. So they pick on the weakest. Yeah, your country is in trouble. They go in and they just come in like vultures, and this is what they are. And when J.P. Morgan, now this was on internet. You could find this for a number of years. You cannot find it now. But J.P. Morgan committed crime so vast that they got a fine of $25 billion. Oh, sorry, I'm sorry, I could have translated this from Danish, so it should say billion there, yeah? $25 billion. What they did was, when you have a deed, when you're going to borrow money, so you have a deed and you take that, certainly in our country and certainly in America, I think probably possibly here as well, if you have a deed and you take out a mortgage in your house, you sign that deed, you take it to the bank, and they go to a public office somewhere and they stamp it. This is how it was. But then the banker said, hey, why don't we make it electronic? It's much easier. And then as soon as they made it electronic, the banks issued several loans on each property. That is why we had only one document. So a system that had been working for hundreds of years, within a couple of years, if not months, this is how criminal they are. Even J.P. Morgan and Bank of America. Bank of America and J.P. Morgan, possibly all the others as well, this is what they did. I mean, we're talking about it's all the way down to like taking a £100 note and putting it in a copy machine. This is fraud, right? And I, you, if you If you go out into the internet now, you can't find anything. It's wiped clean, totally wiped clean. But I'll tell you, this is why they were fined. And I was also asking her, why is it, you know, if you have your GDP is high, even higher than the Danish GDP per capita, why is it that 93 million Americans are out of the workforce? You say you have 4-5% unemployment, but you're not counting in the 93 million. What if you included those? What would the numbers then be? In a capitalist society, right? And then how come you have 50 million on food stamps? And I mean, I just, you know, kind of went a little bit on that. And she didn't like it. And 1 month later, I lost my job. Do you think I regret it that evening? I was blacklisted. I couldn't find a job. Yeah, honestly, I really couldn't. And that's probably why I stand here, because I had so much time in the last 7 years studying. Well, so there you go, Janet Yellen. And now we'll start a little bit talking about money. And so Mervyn King I've met as well. He was, as you know, chairman of the Bank of England. And this is what his words. He said this, not me. I will agree with him, though. Of all the many ways of organizing banking, the worst is the one we have today. Well, I mean, they tell you, you know, I mean, I think literally we just have to go out and demand a better world. And I think a lot of the people in power would actually join in. Well, we had John F. Kennedy, right? I'm sure there are other John F. Kennedys out there. We just need to show them that we are many and we want it. Yeah, we're going to get it. Will this start automatically or do I have to press something? Matthew, there's a video or do I have to do something? Yeah, I think Alan Greenspan is moving his body very slowly in a moment. He's about 200 years old, I think.
Bonds still safe to invest in?
Very much so. I think this is not an issue of credit rating. The United States can pay any debt it has because we can always print money to do that. So there is zero probability
his face.
Of default.
He was like, what? Did you see it? We're going to spend money. What? He had no clue about what money is. He was like me though a few years ago. I'm 4 years old, by the way. I've known how money is created for 4 years. So anyway, moving on. He just said that they can just print more money. America is very, very smart because whenever they borrow money, and we all know they borrow a lot of money, but they only borrow in dollars. While they're advising the countries in Central America and South America to borrow in a foreign currency, right? Because then they can go in and pay off some politicians to run a huge government deficit on the budget. And then they will devalue, and that way, you know, they can take out all the assets of the country. So it's a recipe, but they would never do it in America themselves. And he just explained that. So 100 years ago, when the Federal Reserve was privatized, there was a lot of politicians really fighting for that shouldn't happen. Right now, we have no one. I mean, in Denmark, we had one politician back in 2015, who went into the parliament and talked about how money is created, and it was very hush hush, and then she hasn't said anything since that, and now obviously that's the main reason why I'm kept out of the media, because I'm just saying that it should be the government that produces the country's money, not privately owned banks. And Lindbergh, who was in either the Senate or the Congress, I don't know, but he said that that the invisible government by the money power, they will basically decide when they will create inflation or deflation. They will create depressions, like in 1929 when they removed the monetary base, they create depression. In the 20s, the roaring 20s, they created inflation and a boom. So he explained that. And we have back in Thomas Jefferson, I mean, the present privately owned central bank is actually the third. So there was two 20-year periods where they had a privately owned bank, central bank as well. And he says that, I believe banking institutions are more dangerous to our liberties than standing armies. And I think there was a nice president in the early 60s who said something similar about some secret powers, yeah? Secrecy is repugnant, he said. And this gentleman regretted on, and there's nothing like deathbed confessions, right? In a Christian country, when you realize, oops, maybe there's a life after death. And you just sold out your nation, right? So I'm a most unhappy man. I have unwittingly ruined my country, a great industrial nation. This was Wilson. It was his fault. Basically, he had an affair. And they said, okay, if you don't do what we say, we'll tell your wife. That's it. In those days, I mean, today, in the 60s, if you were gay, and now we all know what it is today, how they control the politicians. We've been talking about that several times over the weekend. It's something to do with children, right? But in those days, that was enough of a scandal. Good old days, I would call it. So basically, they did this in December, when everybody was back on holiday. They put the vote up in the Congress to approve this Federal Reserve Act, the privatization of the nation's money creation, and it was approved. And he regretted that. I should just mention also that an example of government creating money in America could be, for example, the greenbacks that President Abraham Lincoln did during the Civil War, where actually the banksters supported the South, and they wanted the South to win, and the North, they wanted to lend him money at 30%. He said no, and he decided to issue government money to pay the soldiers, and he just issued money. They were called greenbacks, and he said you can pay your taxes with that. He said that to everybody in the country, and the answer, of course, from the banksters in Europe was to make fake greenbacks and send it out. But even so, it was very successful. Another one was President John F. Kennedy, who issued Executive Order 11,110, where you can still probably find it. I know you can find U.S. dollar notes, $1 U.S. dollar note. It says the current dollars. It says Federal Reserve notes. But actually, he issued real money out of the Federal Reserve. He was only a few months before he was taken out. Yeah. He has a book that explains everything very well, The Creature from Jekyll Island. You can read that. And what I think is very important also to notice, because the powers that shouldn't be, they delete. They actually introduced the tax-free foundation at the same time. And this is what you can see with the multinational corporations today, where they use transfer pricing to swindle and do tax evasion. They don't pay any tax whatsoever. So it's the same principle. So Rockefeller and Carnegie, they introduced tax-free foundations, so only the middle class would pay tax, and they would not pay tax. And then they spent that money to control the educational system, for example, to introduce the pharmaceutical industry, the so-called health care system that we have in the West, or lack of healthcare. So this is very important knowledge to have. It's our history, and they've had 100 years, and now it's enough. We have to stop it now. So also in 2008, we had the financial crisis. What happened to the global banks? Oops, they managed to make 12,000 billion. They got 12,000 billion richer, while a lot of people lost their homes. Yeah, it was all created by the crisis were created by the banks, and they benefited. They're really gangsters. So very short, I will explain a little bit about money. It's a lot easier to talk about it now than it was 4 years ago. It's a little bit like the 5G thing, where if you go back just 1 year, nobody talked about it. Now everybody's talking about it. And the same thing with how money is created. If you go back three or four years, nobody talked about it. But now I think a lot of people here certainly will know about it. So I'll do it a little bit shorter than I did a few years ago. But one third of the population, roughly, they believe that money is just created by the government, and then the bank is a middleman between lenders and borrowers. That's about one third. Then two thirds, I have actually understood there's something called fractional reserve banking, the whole concept of that the banks, they don't need to have all the money in the bank all the time because people don't take out all their money all the time. So they have found out that they could have only maybe $10 and they could lend out 100. So they understand there's some kind of fractional reserve bank going on. They don't know exactly how it is. But very few people know that actually money is created as debt by the banks. So basically, if you want to loan 1 million, you write on a piece of paper that you're borrowing a million pounds, and that is then credit for the bank because you promised to pay it back. So that's on the credit side, and then on the debt side, they tap in a number one and six zeros into the computer, and they create new money. It's really that simple. It's not money they had in advance. I don't know about England, but in Denmark they increase on average the monetary base with 80 billion kroner, which is roughly 8 or 9 billion sterling. That's on average. So it's a huge power they have. It's a huge power, yeah. Let's move on. And here you see here Mario Draghi, who was the head of the ECB, I believe, and he says it here: the vast majority of money is issued by private banks. All the bankers, they say it. I mean, you had Mervyn King saying it's the most stupid system we have, and he admits it as well. And if you had gone up to a king a few hundred years ago, telling him that you would make his coins and charge him interest of it, I mean, you would probably be 25 centimeters shorter within a very, very short while, yeah? But now we allow privately owned banks to issue our money. And I mean, they have devalued the US dollar and the Danish currency with 97% in 100 years. So they always say, oh yeah, if the government produce the money, then there'll be inflation, blah, blah, blah. But they have done it themselves. I mean, that is even not so bad. If they had created 97% inflation in 100 years in a straight line, we could all live with that, actually, because we could prepare our private life for it, and it will be fairly easy to know when we will buy a house and so on. We will know it will go up slowly, yeah? But that's not how it is. The 97% they are stealing, it's nothing. What they are really doing is, 1 year they're increasing with 7%, then the next year down with 3, then 2 years ago up 10 and 10, and then up 20, and then down 30. If you add all those numbers up, it's probably 10 to 20 times more. And they all know it. I mean, we're talking about the board members of these private loan banks. They decide in advance how big the monetary base of your country will be. It's insider trading. It's fraud. So seigniorage is the value of creating money. If a king issued a silver dollar, let's say a silver dollar. So I don't know if there's any kingdoms with silver dollars, but let's just imagine a kingdom, and you put in silver for $1, then seigniorage would be zero because it's denominated in $1, and the value of the silver is $1. So he makes no seigniorage. But if he denominates it in $10 and put in one $1 of silver, obviously he makes $9 profit. That's seniors. And if you start issuing notes, so if you put, if you produce a $100 note, it only costs a piece of paper and some ink. So you make $100, and you can pay for public services. You can pay salaries in, through the public sector workers, for example, or welfare, social benefits. So now the banks are creating digital money, and in Denmark, my country, they doubled the monetary base in 4 years. Funny enough, house prices doubled. What a coincidence, right? So it's a huge power they have. I mean, last year in Denmark we had we have a red and a blue, just like in America, and you have Labour and Conservative, yeah. And they were arguing about 1.5 billion kroner, and they actually considered locking out everybody working in the public sector for 1.5 billion. And all the media was saying, look over here, we have a disagreement about 1.5 billion, and we are sending everybody home, potentially. Don't look over here. Banks are creating 80 billion a year. Don't look over here. So it's a scam, and I've been writing to 2,000 journalists for 4 years, all the politicians for 4 years, explaining these things, so they're all in on it. When I say all in on it, it's a bit unfair. I'm sure there are some decent journalists who've been banging their heads against a wall and presenting it to their editors, but so certainly all the editors are in on it, and all the politicians have decided not to spill the beans, apart from this lady, Lisbeth Bech-Poulsen, 4 years ago. So it is a massive, massive power they have, and quite frankly, they don't deserve it because they do insider trading. And how much money is it if you increase the monetary base with 80 billion kroner in my country, or the equivalent per capita here in your country? In Denmark, it is 2,500 kroner. So let's translate that to England, £250 per person per month. This is how much I have calculated that we support the banking system in Denmark, if you equate that into England, yeah? So that means that a family of four in England, tax-free, £1,000 a month. That's on top of whatever, that's all tax rates the same, VAT the same, the benefits the same. This is how much we are supporting the banks right now. And on top of that, they charge interest on the money, and on top of that, they do insider trading, increasing, decreasing monetary bases as they wish. So it is like being in a Tony Soprano movie, and you are the restaurant owner, right? It's simply like the same, and they're using these bully methods. If you come out and you say these things, you know you have the whole society coming down on you and trying to shut you up and threatening you. Now whenever I have any experience whatsoever, I just publish it. So they actually don't target me so much. I don't know why, but they don't. But they target all the people who support me. So they see if they can find them. All of a sudden, they have a problem with the government saying, you're not a good parent. So I'll give you an example. One woman, she has a 14-year-old son, and he thinks the teachers are morons, and he would rather be home playing computer. And she's a good woman, so occasionally she allows him to be there. So they then cocked up something that she was a bad mother, and took him up, and took him and her, he's 14 years old, took him into the social services, and they're going to ask him and potentially remove him from the mother. So they asked the social security workers, they asked the boy, so we hear that your mother is drinking a bit. How many beers does she drink every evening? And the boy said, one. So, case closed, yeah? But it's a lot of stories like that. That another guy, he wanted to help me financially with the party, and he was going to make a lot of money on a building site that he owned, and everything was approved. And then, who comes in? The mayor, last minute, and stops the whole thing. 2 years later, he still hasn't got the permission. So it's not So that's why they are targeting that. They and then, you know, ghost banning on Facebook, YouTube, all that stuff. Yeah, but it doesn't matter. It'll just be much, much stronger when we get through the. It doesn't matter because we are waking up. Especially the 5G is really, really waking up people. Okay, this one it looks very boring, but it's actually not boring. This is the very, very good equation to understand how they're robbing you. If you really get this, it's really, really simple. So the money supply times the velocity of that money is equal to gross times inflation. It's really, really, really important because, so in Denmark, if they increase with 80 billion, the M with 80 billion, 80 billion more krona in the monetary base, you can either have growth in the society or inflation. So if you take, for example, Iceland, they increased M with on an average of 18% from 1965 to 2008. So obviously they can, in Iceland, even though they're very skilled fishermen, they cannot increase production with 18% a year, right? So obviously you can imagine they had a lot of inflation, they had good growth, they have a very high standard of living. It's good to have a monetary base increasing. It's always the opposite what the establishments tell you. Yeah, they tell you it's bad that the monetary base is going up. It's bad to inflation. Actually, inflation is good. Why? Because if you look at my country, I don't know about England, but in my country, Danish people have an average of 70 to 75% mortgage. Let me translate that. That means the banks own 70% of our real estate. Excuse me, did we just have a war? What's going on, right? How can that be? And that's through all these artificial crises. So in 2007, a lot of Danish people bought property on the high, on the peak, and then the market goes down. So basically, we are one recession away. If house prices goes down 25 to 30%, then the banks will own all the properties of Denmark, right? So this is how they do it. So what I'm saying, we should have a lot of inflation until the banks own about 5, 10, 20% of the properties, right? I mean, is there a law saying that the banks should own all the real estate in your country? Is there a law? I've looked through the Constitution, it doesn't say anything there, no? It doesn't say it, right? It says that, you know, you should have your property rights respected, right? So this is very important. If M goes up, one of these two can go up. And a combination of those two. So ideally, I think you should have a lot of inflation until you have transferred the ownership of your real estate to the people. And after that, you should have as much increase in M as you can have more welfare and more quality of life, as much as people want to work. If people decide that now they would like to have more time off, spend more time with their family, or study more, play music, to theater, whatever, then probably you should probably not increase the M too much because then you just have too much inflation. I don't know, but that should be up to the people to decide, not three or four board members in some privately owned corporations, right? So I know it looks a little bit boring, but it's very important. The minute you hear them talking about that there's too much growth in the society, we need to cut back, we need to slow down a little bit. Okay, they're telling us now they're gonna to decrease this bad boy, and then this will go down. Yeah. So they always tell you in advance. You can understand it now if you remember this formula here, that the monetary base influences either growth or inflation. In my political party, I'm recommending this one. It's 100 pages. It's written by a guy who was a very, possibly still is, a very successful IT person in Iceland. He was a member of the parliament in Iceland, and he suggested a monetary reform. And this is what we're suggesting, basically, that a government-owned bank or the Ministry of Finance should issue the money, debt-free. Just like the king used to issue coins, and a privately owned central bank owned by the king or the nation would issue notes, right? Today, if your country issue 100 million in pounds in 100 pound notes. It's revenue. It's revenue for the treasury, and there's no reason why the digital money should not be revenue as well. No reason whatsoever. And he explains this very well with a lot of good literature references. Okay. And this guy was also, again, another central banker spilling the beans. If you want to continue to be slaves to the banks and pay the cost of your own slavery, then let the bankers continue to create money and control credit. I believe it was in the 1930s he said that. So you have good people in all these organizations. It's just they need a little bit of support. We need to be more caterpillars that goes out like Brian Garris explained. This is the plan. When I found out that this was probably my trigger, when I found out that banks are creating money and they're destroying, especially Greece, the way they treated Greece and Ireland was so horrendous. I'd just been in Greece and experienced their hospitality and friendliness in 08, and then the next year they were ruined. And that really infuriated me, really, really infuriated me. And I remember I had a dinner with a German central banker and a German colleague of mine, a very good friend, and we were discussing the Irish situation. And we were, of course, arguing that, of course, the Irish people should not pay for the losses of the foreign banks that had speculated in properties in Ireland. Of course not. This German central banker, I mean, he had a gun, he had shot us. I mean, he was so angry with us. Really, I mean, he was like, you sense that he was ready to send in an army into Ireland, right? Instead, they managed to persuade the Ministry of Finance, or strong manhandle him somehow, or whatever they did. And Ireland, who were close to debt-free, they took on the losses of the foreign banks to the tune of 100% of GDP, just by the signature of the Ministry of Finance. It's a true story. And I hope that that Gemma will get majority in the parliament and jail those people involved in that crime against the Irish people. So, problems are man-made. He's my hero. We'll sort it out. And I love the way that he said, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. This guy was the one talking about conspiracy. What is a conspiracy? A conspiracy is an economic or political crime where at least two people are involved. And you have a lot of people saying, oh, it's a conspiracy theory, as if there are no economic and political crimes committed. I mean, come on. It happens all the time within every single industry we have. Everything is affected. Everything. Healthcare, military, telecom with the 5G, banking, everything is. It's all conspiracies. They have been two people breathing together while they are scheming and planning to commit crimes. So obviously we know the story, or everyone who's here, but maybe some of the listeners don't. But so this is why the CIA concocted this. They need to really knock this down immediately. So they came out with this spin that, oh, it's a conspiracy theory, so that you're being bullied. And this is what they do. They bully. So I knew this. So when I started out, I said to myself, if I'm going to make my own political party, I've never made a speech before and no plan to do this, no intention whatsoever. But this money thing was just too bad. What they did to Ireland, Greece, I just said, no, I'm going to make a speech. But I want at least 1,000 people to be there. So we managed to do that, 1,000 people. And to be honest with you, right now I'm not afraid at all. But, you know, the last day or two before, I was actually quite afraid, to be honest. And I said to my kids, you know, maybe, you know, something might happen to me. And I remember when I took the train, because I don't have a car, I had to sell my two cars, of course, in 2012. So I've been riding a bike and taking the train since then. And when I took the train over to make this speech, I was simply saying, okay, this is my last day. And I was taking this train, I was looking everywhere. When I walked into that the hall of the event, I was like, wow, I made it here, excellent. And then that was, and since then I have not been afraid. I was like, okay, whatever. And I think that the reason that is because I have not sworn anything in any lodge or anything. I'm not sworn that they can kill me, whatever. And I'm not divulging any secrets. It's all totally plain open. Not rocket science. Everybody can see it. It's all I'm saying is just facts. So maybe that's why. But this really triggered me to begin with. So I just started to make a political party, and it's called Jorden, which means Earth. JFK, J for Jorden, which is Earth. Earth, freedom, and knowledge. And it's basically for everybody to have an idea whether a new law is a good initiative. Is it good for the Earth? Will it give you more freedom without damaging other people, nature, animals, or insects? Is it based on facts, knowledge, and wisdom? And if you say yes to all that, it's probably a good idea. It's probably an improvement to what you have already, right? And this facts, knowledge, and wisdom is actually also a little stick to the globalists and the banksters, because that's trivium. Okay? Grammar, logic, and rhetoric. This is a secret way the elites have been teaching their children for 2,500 years. And this is on our program, that all kids should learn trivium. It's very important. So you learn how to think, how to study, instead of learning how to be an order follower, which is what we have today. Yeah? And we have all been through it, so it's all of us, you know. We've all been brainwashed systematically. And it's hard to wake up. So, and with all this surveillance, this is probably speaks for itself, but with all this surveillance and spying, how come pedophiles, rapists, murderers, war criminals, violent drug cartels, slave traders, despots, demon-worshipping child killers, terrorists, traitors, etc. are unhampered in their activities? How can that be? So, once you then start out, It's a little bit hard, yeah? And I know some people say, Matt, you should go slow because people should have, you know, I mean, we've had 18 years with 9/11, right? 18 years. What, they need another 18 years to realize that two planes can't get three towers to collapse in a free fall? Right? Another 18 years? Sure! Yeah? We'll all be killed by 5G before then, right? We don't have that luxury anymore, guys. We just don't, yeah? So first, that's a zombie stage. That's people just, you know, just living their daily life. That's fine, and you enjoy it, hopefully. And then when you hear someone say, teasing you and saying you are a conspiracy theorist, then they actually started their travel to wake up. It's good. Yay, you're stage one. Congratulations, yeah? And that's a cognitive dissonance. Yeah, it's painful for them to listen to something that doesn't fit the narrative they've been brainwashed systematically their entire life. Then the second thing is the anger, and that's because they identify with their the people who are torturing them. Yeah, and the mafia and the bullies and the gangsters for some weird reason. And basically, when I meet those two, I just don't have time. I mean, it's just like, I just block them on Facebook, whatever. Wake up somewhere, in some other else's time. I don't have time for that. Sometimes I spend time on that, but there are so many trolls and shills, so that's normally not something I do a lot of either. But that's what I call a coincidence theorist. That's when they start talking about how these two planes could actually, they start this fire, and then there's a little bit of fire that goes to the third tower, and it goes in there, and somehow there's a little, it ignites, there's a little gap in a window, and it goes in there, and it's breaching, and you know, it's like, all right. And it's with everything, yeah? With the healthcare and everything else. And then, this is what people like, when they wake up and they're depressed, these are the people I spend time on. I'm willing to spend time with these people. To say, okay, it's really bad, yeah? But once we're enough that wake up, we're gonna win this one. And I'm confident we're gonna win it, because we're gonna say no. So So this is, I'm sure everybody here are on level 5 already, and every day more and more people are waking up, so it's good. This is our homepage, and the Trivium stuff you can find on triviumeducation.com. I recommend that. Okay, so now I would like to really quick just run through before I come to the three keys to create abundance everywhere. I just want to go and run through real quick some of the other issues we have, key issues we have in our political party, just to show that it's nothing rocket science, real simple, right? For example, in Denmark, the bureaucracy is so expensive that it costs more than is paid out in Social Security. I mean, how is that possible? How is that even possible, right? So you pay out 150 billion and to people on social, and you pay people who pays it out 150 billion. I would offer to do it for a billion, and the government could save 159 billion, and I'll have a big yacht, and I'll be living in Spain. if it's a win-win. I might even start trading in banksting again for fun. But no, this is just pretty obvious, right? There's something wrong. And then we have, it's a human right to have a place to live. Gaddafi had that in the constitution, right? How can a rich country like Denmark have 6,000 homeless and 350,000 people on waiting list looking for a place to live, living with friends or, you know, somehow with their parents or whatever? In a rich country like Denmark, with the highest average salary, Copenhagen, our highest average salary in the world, I believe. How is that possible? Don't we have bricks? Don't we have builders? Can't we build 6,000 houses or flats? What's going on? So they do build a lot of flats, but they're very expensive. And a lot of them are empty because these banksters, they create money out of thin air, give it to themselves. The 80 billion kroner they produce every year is allocated 90% to speculation in properties in the three largest cities in Denmark. So it's basically, you hand all the enormous value of seigniorage to some of the wealthiest people in Denmark, and they just buy these properties from other very wealthy people. So the money, if you go back, remember the one M times V equals gross times inflation. So the money goes into buildings. That means the V, the velocity, is very small, because if you buy something from a billionaire, he just sends it straight to Panama, right? Or Switzerland, wherever he keeps his money. So what we want to do is, of course, that money, those 80 billion, goes out to everybody. So they are spending money and buying from each other. So this is really simple. And then you have added tax instead of value added tax. So value added tax is a nuisance for the bookkeeping. Is bookkeeping very expensive? And you could just issue an added tax. So which is something that you cannot deduct it. You have to pay it. So whenever you are, if you're importing some, let's say you're importing £1 million of clothes, you pay, say, 100,000 in added tax, or 50,000, whatever the added tax rate might be, right? And then let's say it's 10%, for example. So you pay 100,000, and then when the shop sells it on for £2 million, they pay 200,000. So you can ka-ching. The country makes more money out of it. And you transfer the tax from the service sector to the import of goods. So you're moving the taxation from humans to dead things, right? So this is something, one of the things that I think is quite simple. And at the same time, you have no bookkeeping, no bureaucracy with this, because it just goes automatically. Whenever you buy this, you just pay it. You can't deduct it. There's nothing, yeah? And then we need more councils and more economic activities in the parishes, because the more you decentralize, the less they can control it and the less mistakes they can make. Because if you make a little mistake in one parish and the two or three neighboring parishes do a lot better, the ones that are the small ones that make mistakes, they look at the other ones and you can recover real quick. If you make a mistake 1 or 2 years, doesn't matter, you'll catch up within a short space of time. But if you concentrate everything, like look at the Soviet Union, everything was decided in Moscow. Look how inefficient that was, tremendously inefficient. And then obviously I've been talking about this, loans from IMF and the World Bank should be should always be interest-free, because otherwise it's not a help, right? We should, of course, exit all these free trade agreements, because it's not free trade. It's only benefiting the multinational corporations. So they can, for example, if you some of these TTIP thing, they can go in and say to Egypt, if they want to raise the minimum rates, they can say that then they can take them to court, and in a court in a country they don't know where it is and who's in this court. And some reason the multinational corporations, they normally win these court cases. So. So it's horrible. We should just exit all of them. It should just be closed down. It should have bilateral negotiations, country by country. Go back to the old EU, where you can have trade agreements between countries that are similar. You should dissolve corporations committing crimes against humanity. Yeah. For example, I heard on Gemma O'Doherty's excellent radio program or YouTube channel with Robert Kennedy, I heard that GSK, Merck, Sanofi and Pfizer have paid the last 10 years alone for fraudulent studies and surveys fines of $35 billion. They are so big criminals that they have to pay $35 billion, and still they're telling us that natural medicine is dangerous and so on. But they have actually paid fines for this, and these are the people producing the vaccines that the government wants us to inject. So this is like criminal people who will commit fraud for $35 billion. We allow them to create our vaccines. It's absolutely, it's an insane asylum, basically. They all need to be changed out, yeah? So, and then, of course, Dexit, as long as EU is run by an unelected commission, why would we? We were just so happy that Soviet Union stopped, right? A natural medicine, of course, should be at least equal to allopathic medicine. You know, we heard a lot about that, the GC math and all the other stuff. Of course we should. Why are there no billionaires dying from cancer? We all know that, right? And then we have agriculture without GMO, pesticides, ecologic, biodynamic, and permaculture. It should be allowed. Basically, a lot of common sense, right? I mean, I think it's the same in England, but certainly in Denmark, at least 95% of our ancestors were farmers. If they saw what we're doing to our soil, the soil erosion, then the way you just have a monoculture as long just one grain, for as far as I can see, right, it's just destroyed. And we have one of the speakers yesterday saying that the cows were just eating grass and they should be eating herbs and leaves and so on, yeah. And this is the kind of agriculture we should go back to. We should stop this crazy stuff. And a lot of the farmers are against it because they're brainwashed. So what we should, of course, do, we should help them with the financing, interest-free loans and so on. That's really easily done. Obviously, we have also in our one of our key issues, weather modification and geoengineering can only be allowed after a referendum. And then, of course, full public transparency. And just for me, having this issue is something very scary for the establishment. They don't even want to talk about it. But it's just like pretty plain obvious. I'm not saying you're doing it, but if you were, it should be after referendum, right? I mean, what are you going to do? Educational system should be based on trivium. We probably don't have time to go into that, but it's very important, very short, like basically grammar, logic, rhetoric. So trivium is basically very, very, very short version. You should listen to maybe Mark Pashew and the other page, triviumeducation.com, and a lot of people much, 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 much better than me to explain it. But it's basically something to do with grammar. You want to study something. First, look at all the facts. And then you go logic, which is you ask all the questions, why, how, when, how many, and so on. And then you do all that study, and then eventually the wisdom will come, the rhetoric. And what the system, the school system we have, and it's not only the school system, it's also the universities, is that the professor or the teacher will give you a fact, such as, for example, cancer can't be cured. That's the fact, right? And then that's the logic they give you. And then you have to go out and find facts that proves that the professor and the teacher are correct or right. then you pass the exam. But if you come back with facts that disproves the professor, then you won't get your exam. So I've been training my kids, our three kids, trivium, and also, yes, you need to know what's going on, and then you also need to do the blah 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 to get your degrees, right? So this is very important. And then also, I think it's very important, John Taylor Gatz, who is my biggest favorite, I recommend him very, very much. And I think that all teachers should understand how children learn. Some are visual, some are kinesthetic, some are auditive, all these things. You know, we have a lot of ideas, and it's all written on our webpage. Again, it's nothing. It's not rocket science. It's just so obvious. And again, we can just do it on a volunteer basis. Just have some of the schools being like that, and then you have all the kids wanting to be there. Then media lies and war propaganda shall be prosecuted. I mean, it's not enough that they come out and say it's a mistake, right? I mean, we've been making a few demonstrations, or it's not demonstration, we just went out painting in chalk outside Denmark's Radio, and they came out and discussed with us, some of the journalists, and they said, oh, it was a mistake. Yeah, there was a mistake every single war. You told the lies, the propaganda from the globalists. They're already ready to do it with Venezuela and Iran already, right? And then they say, yeah, but it was reliable sources. Well, is it really reliable if they've been wrong every single time so far? Yeah. What are you doing? So we need to do that. And one of the things that they like to blow out of proportion is I have actually written this because I think it's quite important, because we used to be a Christian nation in Denmark. And our party is, of course, totally secular. You can believe in whatever you want. But if it used to be 99% Protestant, and it goes through a transition of being atheist and now blatantly satanic Luciferian, and I mean that, Denmark is now blatantly Luciferian. Why? And okay, that's a bit tough pill to swill, but swallow. But if it's egoism and nihilism and materialism, and families are breaking down, and you have the world record in single parents now, and 57% of adult Danes are living as a single people, and so de facto it is like that, and I just think, okay, fine, if that's what you want, if that's Danish people's choice, that's fine, but you should at least know what you're doing. Right? So let's just start with rating the movies and the films, because it's social engineering. So let's start rating them 1 to 10. So you can see when you are going to watch a movie, how much rating, how much indoctrination will you get from that? And today I was actually in the press for the like third time or something like in Denmark in a small paper. And they said now that I was a champagne socialist and a false flag. Because I said a lot of right thing, but then I threw this one in, so obviously I was a false flag, yeah? Yeah, they like to say that something as well, but anyway, so, yeah, and then obviously out of Codex Elementarius, so that's Codex Elementarius, I think probably we are like maybe a few hundred people in Denmark who know what that is, but that is an unelected group in Switzerland that decides all the food standards in Europe. And I don't want to dwell a lot over it. Just this fact alone should be enough to stop it. Basically, in 2003, 176 nations prohibited 9 poisons in food. It took only these globalists 5 years to introduce 7 of them. So we are now eating 7 poisons. We are feeding our children 7 different poisons that 176 nations made outlawed in 2003. And that should be enough to immediately, quite possibly, jail some of these people. Yes. But certainly we should not adhere to their rules at all. Okay, and obviously planned obsolescence, come on, we all know that, it's pretty simple. It's not rocket science. it should not be allowed. And if they want to do it, with, I mean, I saw a movie with a I think it was a fire station in New York where they opened a bottle of champagne and they had a light bulb. It has worked for 100 years. So they celebrated that with champagne. It was fantastic to see. So they planned it. I mean, they had meetings. The globalists had meetings, how long each product should last. And then they're talking about climate change and, yeah, we should look up. I mean, they are liars in your face, yeah? Okay, and then I have been speaking with one of the leaders of the Yellow Vests in France. See, a lot of the people joining the political party I started are people who haven't been voting for 10 years, 15 years, right? A lot of the people are saying that I will never vote. A lot of the people come in. So you have like that group are either very for, pro my party or very much against it because they're just against all politicians. So it was great for me to talk to this guy, the Yellow Vest Movement, and he said that they want to be a political party. I think it's at least 2.5, maybe 3 years to the next election, but they have one key issue, and that is if 1% of the French population demands a referendum, they have to have a referendum on whatever subject they wish. And if 50% plus votes yes, guess what? The parliament has to make it a law. And I like that a lot, because that way you can take a lot of the power away from parliament back to the people, where it belongs. So, and I like that a lot because I like what the Yellow Vest they say about they want to have a better welfare state, they want to have lower taxes, and they want a lot of good things. And now I'm going to explain how you can afford all of that. Because it's possible. And that's why I put on the Yellow Vest. And as soon as, of course, we did that, I mean, they did that anyway, the Danish television is just full of how the Yellow Vest people are, they are burning cars, and you've seen all these stories, just brainwashing. So when we are walking around with the Yellow Vest, people are kind of a little bit of, I don't know, you know, uncomfortable. Let's put it that way, uncomfortable, yeah? So we have a huge day, the 1st of May, all the left-wing parties are in our biggest park in Denmark, and we decided to go, of course. We are the only party who can actually deliver the welfare because we have the solutions, right? So of course we should be there, which is kind of ironic being a banker, and I was right-wing all my childhood and all my upbringing, so it's quite ironic that I have started the first People's Party in Denmark, real People's Party. I mean, we have no support from any wealthy people whatsoever. It's just ordinary people sending £10, £20. We are only funded by that, and I don't have a salary whatsoever. It's everything is going for the campaign and the promoting the idea of the party and so on. But we went into this the 1st of May, and there's this big scene where all the speakers are. Were we allowed to speak? No. But we came in our Yellow Vest with about 50 people, and with big banners, vote for Mads Palsvig and stop 5G radiation and so on. And it was very interesting to see. So you have like the big stage up here, and this is the whole thing. You have, and then the park is all the way out here. It's very big, but you have a lot of people here. And we were standing here in the middle, and then we had 4 meters around us everywhere. I've never seen that in my life. It's unbelievable. So we were there standing there having a great time with each other and so on, and talking. All the people who came, who wanted to talk to us, came over to us and talked to us. We had a great, great time. But people were standing like this over here and over here to watch the scene up there. But where there were grass all the way around. Very strange. I don't know if we had this energy or they were afraid of us or whatever it was. It was just an observation, which was interesting. But this is certainly a very good thing that I would encourage all of you to, if you are in any political party, to bring this out, because this is probably not something you heard in the news, I guess. I hadn't heard it. But it's good. So now, let's start with the solutions. There are 3 steps to the solution. Let's start with Africa. Obviously, Gaddafi, he created this so-called miracle. So Libya was the poorest country in the world when he took over, and it was one of the wealthiest. Free healthcare, free education. It was in the constitution to have a home, and they paid half of your first car, electricity was pretty much free, I believe, and everything was very cheap. So he had a good quality of life. He spent $63 billion making a man-made river, And so you could get land for free if you wanted to become a farmer. Hey, please go help yourself if you want to do that. And so he did a great thing. And what he did was he issued the country's money. That's the main thing. Yes, they had oil as well, but the main thing was he created money as credit without interest. So this is the most important thing. Now, I'm going to tell you all these three things, and this is my hope for today, that you go out of here and understand these things so you can look into it more and talk to your friends about it. Because if you do these three things, you can have as much abundance, welfare, lower taxes as you want. This is the key. So number one, the government produces the money. For example, I am suggesting to begin with 4%. You increase the monetary base with 4% a year. Then you would get, remember, MV equals GI. So if you increase M with 4, then the G and I should go up with 4. Say 2% inflation, 2% growth, just to make it simple, yeah? But, there's nothing stopping you from increasing the monetary base a lot more if you want to transfer the ownership of your properties from the banks to the people. You could do that, right? Okay, that's number one. Number two, interest-free loans for humans, primary home and car. This is huge. So in Denmark, or in England as well, I'm sure, when you're paying your mortgage, you're paying to the banks. Why not pay to yourself? Wouldn't that be great? And also, let's say you put out a 20% down payment. You live there a couple of years. So you now own maybe, let's say you own 25, 30% of the house. And let's say that you have something happens in your life. You know, you want to look after your parents, you're unemployed, something happens. You can just go down to the publicly owned or privately owned mortgage institute and say, you know what, is it okay with you if I don't pay my mortgage the next 3 to 6 months? What's going to happen? They can say yes. Why? Because the government, the country, shouldn't care about whether you own your house after 30 years or 30 years and 3 months. Who cares? If you need 3 months for something personal, this is the cheapest form of welfare. Just allow people live in the house for free for a few months. What's the problem? The government can never, ever, ever lose money lending to its own citizens if they control this bad boy. If the government controls the monetary base, there is no way you can lose money lending to your own population with the security of property. It's impossible. So this is a secret that you're not allowed to know. But now you know it, let's all be caterpillars and tell as much many people about it as possible, yeah? And the third one is basically you can abolish income tax completely. And if you introduce a two-pin tax, so two-pin tax was basically only on foreign exchange and equity trades and so on. But I'm suggesting a 1% tax on all digital transfers of money. And I'm mainly doing this to ensure that Rockefeller, Carnegie, and all the owners of the multinational corporations and the multinational corporations, they pay their fair due of taxes. This is very smart because they cannot operate without transferring money. And they haven't paid any money for hundreds of years. Did you just notice how easy this was, right? How simple this is, right? These are three secrets they've kept for you your entire life. And now it took me less than 2 minutes to go through them, or 5 minutes, right? This is it. This is how simple it is. It's not rocket science, right? So what we're going to do, we're going to take back the power to produce money back to the people, back to the government, and interest-free loans and tax transfers of money. You end up living with a cheap mortgage, and if you want to rent, that's what will happen with the rental market. If it is very cheap to buy your own property, more people will buy a house. And so the rental market will collapse. It'll be much, much cheaper even to rent. If for some reason you need to study or you need to move, or there are a lot of reasons why you want to rent in a period of your life. Everybody does that, right? So these are the three solutions. And I hope you will talk to your friends and your political party. I've been suggesting this for 3 years to all political parties in Denmark. And this is another proof that they are all in the pocket of the multinational corporations, because not a single left-wing party has suggested any of this. And it's so simple. This is enough. And also, another proof in the pudding is they all voted for the 5G. So they all the left-wing political parties who say that they are so concerned about the climate and people's health and so on, voted to in the interest of the telecommunications industry. And then, of course, Libya. All the political parties voted to bomb Gaddafi. Even the Communist Party and the Socialist People's Party and the Social Democratic Party, and they all voted for it. So they're all in the pocket of the globalist, all of them. But it has to stop now. We have to be more people going out, speaking the truth about it. And we should talk about a Nuremberg trial. They should talk about it. Yeah? I want them fighting between themselves. I want them fighting. I want them head for the door, because we'll become more and more people, and we'll become braver and braver, and we will win it. I'm sure we will win it. This is how you do it in the practical side. So we put on the yellow vests. We are walking with banners, and we're handing out flyers. So we're handing out. So one of the flyers would be this one here. I'm trying to look as scary as possible, not for you, but for those bastards. And then on the back, you probably can't see it, but I'll tell you what it is. On the back, we have a pregnant woman holding her stomach, and then we have here, 5G radiation, no thank you. And since we come out with this, I'm telling you, the amount of women joining our party is just going through the roof. Through the roof, yeah? And then we have this one. We go out. This is mainly for the television stations and the radio stations. Then I go out and I hand out flyers. It's basically a typical flyer. Picture of Libya before we bombed them and after. You know these typical horrible paintings, yeah? And then in here, the little boy from Syria, who was all in full of flour and ketchup, and then they said that it was a gas attack. You know, it was so ludicrous, yeah? And then the parent and the father took them to court, and they won it in the International Court of Hague. They won the court case against NATO. That it was fake news, yeah? And then I have, I touched the button I shouldn't touch, Matthew. I did the go one down, yeah? Okay, gotcha. And then there's Theresa May with a long nose because of the thing, yeah? And then I have a picture of American soldiers protecting the poppy seeds. And I have a picture here of the Syrian Assad, and then it's a Danish newspaper, it was in the Times as well, that actually, if you remember all those head-chopping videos, that Pentagon had spent $530 million producing those videos. So that's fake news as well, in your face. So I come out there, and I hand this fake news and war propaganda that they have made, and we give them to the journalist. I'm telling you, when we stood in front of the main building, it's massive, massive building, thousands of people working there. We're handing this out to them, and everybody who was around there. And whenever one went out or in of that building, we just stood there and said, fake news. That's all we did. Fake news. And literally, they showed with their body that we were right, because they all went like this, with their head in shame, which it should be, you know? So this was a great day. It was a very special day for me, and very uplifting, because I love bees. We have outside our house. We have hundreds and hundreds, maybe thousands of bees outside our house, just living there in the free. Quite astonishingly, one of them landed there on my shoulder, and I was very pleased with that. And this happened just after, very strange, on the main town hall square. there was a hawk attacking a dove right next to me, and they were attacked it, brought it up, and I was filming it, yeah, and it went up down, and in the end, I thought, who's gonna win it? And then the hawk gave up. And it was like, I'm just making a demonstration and you have this fight. It was just very, 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 very strange for me. Very weird. And then the next minute, a bee lands on my shoulder. Like, what? This is outside Danmarks Radio, yeah? Fake news, 5G, and then an arrow pointing over to that building, yeah? Which is over there somewhere. But it's a massive area, so we write fake news Libya, and the front door we wrote fake news, we wrote war propaganda is illegal, and we wrote Nuremberg, and we wrote public service, you have to live up to your public service, and so on, all that stuff. And then the police came. Basically, we did it on a Friday. They thought it was real paint. And we came back Monday morning, 5:30, and I've said to everybody, okay, so the police is probably gonna show up. So I want everybody to be in their best clothes, yeah? So we had, there was two women there, in very nice clothes, long leather boots and so on. I had one of the main supporters of me who is out with me every day since October handing out flyers, a former owner of a factory. He's 75 years old. He was with a hat and a nice suit. And then everybody, a lot of people were dressed up. And we were about 10 of us. And then we wrote all this stuff on the Monday morning, 5:30, for about half an hour. And then they, of course, called the police when we have painted the whole area. We finished up in front of the main entrance. They called the police, and we were already ready to go. We saw one police car, and we decided just to wait. So we were standing there waiting for them, yeah? And they came, three police car and a big van to take us away, obviously, because we're very dangerous, right? So they came there, full gun, bulletproof vest, everything, yeah? And they were very intimidated. That's vandalism, and we're going to take you to court, this, that, and the other. And then one of them came up to this lady, she's a pilot, very, very elegant woman in our party. And this policeman came up, he was not as tall as she is, but there you go, can't have everything. So he came up to her and he said, is that you, that's vandalism? And then she just smiled patiently on him, she just smiled on him and he said, and then she did like this, and she looked down, and her boots is white with chalk, right? What are you, Sherlock Holmes, right? You know. And then she did like this, and she removed it with a bit of water, and then he couldn't stop laughing. He had to turn away from everything, yeah. And he was like, so half the police thought it was really funny, yeah. So it went all well, and next day we went back because I had to have a conclusion, see what's going on. So we had to come back. We came back the next day, police came call again. Seven people only came this time. And we said, what are you doing? Oh, we were just writing with chalk and handing out flyers. And then, okay, that's actually not illegal. We have to go. Then they went. And then we did it another five times. And they called the police every time, but the police never came back. Another five times. We have to tell them, we disrespect them, they do not deserve our respect when they commit war propaganda, which causes so much suffering in other countries. It's not, they do not, and they film it themselves and in these fancy studios, and they take all these politicians in there who have committed all these crimes, and they are portraying them, those people to the people as if they are worshipping. They are not. They are really bad people. So, and now we said, okay, so obviously nobody has a clue who I am because I'm out of the media, yeah? So we started back in October, and the focus was the election the 5th of June. Started back in October, we handed out 40,000 flyers, talking to people every day since October, talking to one face to face, yeah? And I'm on election in an area of Copenhagen with 360,000 voters, and I need 20,000, I need 5% to get in. So that's steep. If this will be the first time ever in history anybody has been elected with no money, totally kept out of the media. This will be the first time ever it has happened. And if that happens, it will probably encourage a lot of other people. So we are working on that. And now what we've done is we write everywhere we talk, who is Mads Palsvig? Everywhere, in front of all train stations, everywhere, roads, buildings, town hall, we write it everywhere, yeah? Who is Mads Palsvig? This bad boy. I don't want to meet him in a dark evening, you know. 5G radiation, no thank you. Yeah? Because they made a mistake. They're so arrogant that the Danish people were so brainwashed that they could all vote for the 5G radiation, right? But they did that in December, and in January I made a video explaining in 8 minutes, I was with a suit, explaining very meticulously how dangerous this is, how bad it is. And that went viral, and it started a lot of Facebook groups anti-5G in Denmark since then, yeah? So this is their mistake, because you can't say that you're working for the people if you are working for the telecom industry. People are really waking up to this. The 5G is their Achilles heel. And it's also very important because it's so dangerous. So, yeah, so this is it. These are the placards we are putting up. And I have made a little video, and now I know how to operate the machine. Look at me. Where's the mouse? Matthew, do we have a minute? The mouse is... Can you see the mouse? Oh, you can see it. Oh. Doing pretty good for a moron, hey. This is my street. These are people who were waiting for the placards.
Så er vi live fra Mads Palsvigs indkørsel.
Og
der er kommet...
This is how we do it in Denmark in practice, yeah? Changing the system.
De agter brede ud.
And that's my grandson.
I græsen, så...
Ja, Marco. He's a JFK guy. Yellow vest.
Så er der gang i valgkampen her. Welcome, Billy. Stem for Mads Palsvig.
Det må du gerne. Der er hyggeligt i fløn.
Absolutely, 2,000 of them in 24 hours, yeah. Who's Mads Palsvig?
Så jeg står her sammen med Mike.
I'm standing here with Mike.
Vi har skrevet lidt mere med Mads Palsvig.
We have written Who's Mads Palsvig.
Vi har plakater op hele vejen rundt.
We put a lot of placards up all the way around. So that's a bit of how we're doing it in practice. That's my boy. And a good friend of mine who's in the party, who's fighting a heart. And I thought, this is my grandson, isn't he lovely? Yeah, this is why I'm doing this. I want him to have a good life. And they can come at me and they can do whatever they want. I will fight for this boy. Even these three kids, yeah, they're not as pretty as my grandson, yeah? And the hero. And then the last word, don't keep calm, go out, make change. The earth is being destroyed by psychopaths. Let's all be caterpillars. Thanks so much.